pour the water at top here into this tank. And it doesn't need a lot of water. In fact, water is a perfect carrier of hydrogen, as it is primarily H2O.
Okay.
So all that we do is, once it's inside the tank, it flows into our proprietary electrolysis cell that sits at the base of the stove here. I'm going to come across on this side.
Okay.
And actually, what I'll do is I'll show you how fast it electrolyzes. This is fascinating. How quickly it creates the gas. So take a look at this. As soon as I open it, you'll see the hydrogen gas coming out.
Okay.
So that's the gas there. Mm-hmm. It's quite faint, but as you can see it, that's the hydrogen gas being produced immediately from
the
water.
The gas is already
there. It's already there.
Less than two seconds, the gas is being produced.
So now, as I close it, what's happening is the gas is then being rerouted to the burners here. There's two burners.
Okay.
So once I turn it off, turn it on again, there are two burners. I'll go ahead and
actually see bubbles of water from there.
That's it. That's the gas with the bubbles. And then I'm just going to go ahead and ignite this flame. And as you can see, hydrogen burns orange. So this is actually a very hot
water
flame.
That's a flame.
Roughly 1600 degrees, but we had to make the flames quite small in order to make very efficient cooking. So this
and
is one of the most
really hot. I could actually
really
feel the heat.
Yeah, already or even sitting there, right? Yeah.
So how long can a bottle of water last? How many? You know, in Kenya, the
favorite
delicacy is githeri.
Yeah.
It's boiled here for probably 2 hours.
Yeah.
How much water would I need to boil food for 2 hours?
Fantastic question. I'll just go ahead and turn it off so you could hear that. But very simple. That's how it works. And with this technology, what's most fascinating about it is how little water it uses. This tank holds 2 liters of water.
Mm-hmm.
From our calculations, we've been able to cook for 5 days on 2 liters of water.
Mm-hmm.
5 days. So
Wow, 5 days, 2 liters of water. Wow. Sounds like a Globehead's dream come true, doesn't it?
Hydrogen on demand.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well,
sure.
Yeah. Did you like how he said at the very beginning?
I was more interested in the sign language woman in the bottom.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But
especially when she was doing this.
But it was very interesting when he said that water is a carrier of hydrogen.
All right, sure. I would have thought he'd say that water contains hydrogen.
You can be very intelligent and very good at what you do, and you can still be stupid.
Yes, we're back again, annoying people with our views and opinions,
because.
All us.
A lot of people dislike hearing other people's views and opinions.
Yeah, that's absolutely true, we're back again. Obviously, the time has flown. The past 2 weeks have flown by, you know.
Yeah, they come round very quickly.
We seem to be doing one talk through every fortnight, and like the weeks are flying by. Surprising. The whole year's going to be over in no time.
But
back again, obviously annoying people with our views and opinions, because a lot of people think the very weird things to be true, even though those things have not been proved to be true.
Yeah.
They still think in their heads that they are true.
And that's why we consider that it's just a belief.
Absolutely, it's just
a belief.
Like planet Earth is just a belief. It's nothing more, nothing less. You have to believe in planet Earth in order for it to be true, or any resemblance of it being true. You have to believe it to be true.
Because
in the real world, it's not a globe, you know, in my opinion, you know, and a lot of other people's opinions. I'm not the only person who shares the view that the Earth is this level plane. You know, a lot of people share that view. And to those people, the Earth is not a globe, you know. It's not my fault, is it, you know?
Not my fault either.
But anyway, so what have we got on for everyone's displeasure for today then, Peter?
Well, for everyone's displeasure with a capital D.
Oh, yeah,
D.
D-R-S-P-L-E-A-S-U-R-E.
We're going to have a look at liquid hydrogen and silicon oxide, because they say that silicon is a source of hydrogen.
Some guy left us a comment and said, here you go, this is proof that water's made of H2O, hydrogen and oxygen.
So we're going to look at liquid hydrogen reacting with, or silicon. Made to react with silicon.
Silicon, yeah, sure, at high pressure.
Yeah,
basically. And high elevated temperature.
Yeah, well, so we're going to have a look at that. Joule driver, not screwdriver, but Joule driver.
But he certainly lost a screw, that's for sure. Got a screw loose, that's for sure.
Yeah, we're just going to talk about the ISS and the eclipse, because the recent eclipse that occurred in America.
Absolutely, yeah, sure.
We're just going to look at his comment. I was talking with someone the other day, and I mentioned about hydrochloric acid in our stomachs.
Yeah, allegedly we've got hydrochloric acid in our stomach.
And I'm like thinking,
The acid breaks down the food.
Yeah, so
helps to break down food.
We're going to have a look at that, just to pose a few questions to our subscribers.
Well, we're going to pose a few questions. Well, we're going to make people think whether hydrochloric acid is actually in our stomachs.
Yes, so we're going to look at that. Wowie left us a comment.
Oh, Wowie, yeah, Wowie.
Left us a comment about ozone. So we thought, well, we cover that one in this video. We're going to Stuart Gray. We've been communicating.
Isn't that David Gray's brother?
Stuart it could Gray. Have been, yeah.
Sure.
We're going to
could have been Earl Gray. Could have been a descendant of Earl Gray. Yeah, Earl Gray tea, you know. Yeah.
But we're going to cover a comment of him. He's a renowned globe head.
He's a believer. He believes in the globe.
He believes that a rocket can work in space.
Yeah, he's a believer in the globe. He thinks the globe is real.
Yeah. Tropica Optica left us, give us a link about a Large Hadron Collider.
So we're going to have a look at that.
And Rune Thorson asked us to have a look at nuclear weapons.
Obviously, because we've got the Ukraine war going on, and Israel, and lots of people panicking about the
third world war
and nuclear
Everyone's
war.
Everyone's going to die.
And scaremongering, you know, that's what it's all about.
Scaremongering.
And a lot of people are, probably getting really worried that they're even making their bunkers now. They're even stocking up tinned food.
Tinned food, yeah.
They're probably doing that, and toilet rolls.
Yeah, can't forget those.
So
we're also going to have a look at this. Planet Earth is just a belief, because we're going to revisit.
What are we going to revisit? A Netflix video.
That
came out years ago.
It came out years ago. Some people probably already covered it, but we thought we'd remind people.
Oh, sorry. And we're going to cover Dave McKeegan's video where he covered that helicopter.
That's right.
Because some people obviously think the video's fake.
Because I haven't seen that video either.
You've not seen it, but we'll have a look. And there is some evidence that does support the idea that the video is fake. But, you know, we've seen other video footage of, like, the Marignane Airport.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's quite feasible to accept that, you know, the helicopter, you know, does rise behind the water, as it were. You know?
But anyway, we'll cover that later on. But let's get back to the video we showcased at the beginning.
Oh, right, yeah, okay, yeah, sure. So let's get started. I can't remember who gave us this link to this video.
Hydrogen on demand.
Hydrogen on demand. Somebody gave us ovens. Somebody gave us a link to this anyway. I'm just looking. Electrolysis takes electricity to separate water into hydrogen. This is Huntley who left a comment. Electrolysis takes electricity to separate water into hydrogen and oxygen. So how long does the battery last? Obviously, there's this new product, new gizmo on the market, you know.
If you want to go camping.
I'll just turn the volume down.
Yeah,
you're on. There you go. And now we'll replay it. So the guy's filling up this stove with a little bit of water. And as far as I'm aware, there's an electrolyte mixed in with the water. There would have to be,
yeah,
because it's using electrolysis.
But he might not tell the people that who he's demonstrating it to.
And it's got a battery pack, obviously. You need battery to produce the electricity that will then run through the electrodes, conduct electricity through the electrolyte, and produce your hydrogen and oxygen gas. And basically, he starts it up, switches it on, electrolysis is produced, the gases are coming out of the top there, you know, wet gases, because there's water present, obviously. So he puts the top on, and obviously the gases are now being diverted through the stove, and give it a bit of time, and he's able to light the gas, isn't he? Ignite the gas, okay? Which is super, you know, straightforward, nothing too spectacular at all. I like it when she's doing this and going like that.
Oh, right. Yeah.
But I think that's what it means by burning, or the stove or something. But so you can see that you've got a flame there, and the guy's selling, flogging a product, so he's obviously going to sell it.
Yeah.
Putting on his selling sales rep spiel to the purchaser, potential purchaser, because he wants money. That's all he's doing it for, is money.
I mean, when you think about it, it's quite a reasonable product to have, because you don't need to have a large gas cylinder.
Yeah, you don't need to hump around a large gas cylinder. You can take that camping, that'd be perfect.
Yeah, so it is, in some ways, quite a good product.
I can't knock it. So. Yeah, you can have a barbecue, couldn't you?
You can have
a little barbecue.
Yeah.
But let's go back. But as well, it's a water-powered stove. They advertise it as a water-powered stove. And yet it's not powered by water at all. Mm. You know, it's wrong.
Yeah.
It's wrong.
Yeah.
It's wrong to be doing this.
We should report these to the trading standards.
Absolutely, because it's not a water-powered stove at all.
They're misrepresenting this product.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. The water breaks down the electrolyte, okay, which then enables electricity to flow between the anode and cathode, okay. And then in so doing...
Via the electrolyte. Not the water.
Not the water, because water doesn't conduct electricity. And then you have breakdown of the anode. So you get gases being released through the breakdown of your electrolyte, and gases being produced as a breakdown of your electrodes, especially your anode, anodic decomposition. Yeah. You'll get the gases produced. Those gases are collected and then channeled through into the
burner,
the burners, which you then light, and then you've got your gas. Yeah. But you're not splitting water. It's not a water powered stove. You know, it's bullshit.
It's misconception.
Absolutely. Now, a lot of people probably agree with us out there, but a lot of people disagree with us. But if you disagree with us, you have to falsify our view. And the only way you can falsify our view is by proving that water contains hydrogen and oxygen.
Yeah.
And I don't know how you're going to do that.
Yeah.
I haven't a clue how you're going
to
do that.
Yeah. But a couple of things I'd like to point out is, if you play the beginning of the video and put the volume up.
Right, okay, so let's play
because it's important what he says.
So let's listen to this. You ready?
So we just pour the water at top here into this tank. And it doesn't need a lot of water. In fact, water is a perfect carrier of hydrogen, as it is primarily H2O.
Okay.
So although we do...
Yeah, see there, he's saying water is a perfect carrier of hydrogen. See, he then goes on and says that because water's H2O, but water wouldn't carry hydrogen if it was breaking down. If they were splitting the water, the water wouldn't carry the
hydrogen. I understand where you're coming from. But you see, the thing is that you've got the electrolytic cell, you've got the gases produced, obviously, would be hydrogen and oxygen, and the gases produced would be wet gases.
Absolutely.
So water, not in the form of vapour, but in the form of gaseous water, would be produced, and it would migrate along with the hydrogen and the oxygen, and then it will come out of this stove.
Yeah.
Because you'll find that if you lit that flame, that stove, in a sealed environment, you'd get water condensing, droplets of water forming around the walls.
Yeah, so the water is poured in at the top into the tank. Basically. It's just going through the system and out through the flame.
Yeah, and appearing on the walls of the tent, or your camping tent or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, so that in itself is kind of like evidence to support the idea that you can't destroy water, you can't create it, you can't split it into hydrogen and oxygen. Water is water at the end of the day.
It can only change from one form to another.
So solid, ice, to liquid, to liquid, to vapor, and vapor to
gas.
You've got steam in there, obviously, but you've got gas. You can have gaseous water. This is what a lot of people don't tell you, but water can exist as a gas.
Yeah. And we all know, well, people who watch this channel should know that even how they produce methane or natural gas delivered to your gas stove at home, along the network, they'll always have dog legs at certain intervals where water collects.
Yeah, and the water's there primarily because it comes from the steam reformation process
of the natural gas to clean it.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. So you've got gaseous water that basically carries the hydrogen.
Yeah, basically.
So it's an energy carrier.
Water is an energy carrier.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's quite straightforward to understanding, yet a lot of people, I don't know why, they won't accept it. They won't accept this information or our view. You know, they won't accept it. They'll just think, no, water's made of H2O.
Yeah, but they want to think that the hydrogen's coming from the water because water is abundant.
Yeah, but it's not, though. It's not. Water is not abundant.
Because all, in our view,
There's only X amount of water on the Earth.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah. In our understanding, the hydrogen is coming from the materials that are placed in the water that are decomposed. Yeah. And a lot of those substances man manufactures.
Absolutely, of course. Sorry, a lot of people might think that water is abundant. I mean, you've got ice everywhere and oceans, okay, but it's still limited.
Yeah,
it's still limited in the amount of water that's on the Earth. There's only X amount of water. It can only change from one form to another, obviously.
Yeah,
but you've still got the same amount of water.
Yeah,
and that's it.
Yeah, one thing I would like to say is, whatever you do, if you do happen to buy one of these, I'd be very careful about the type of saucepan that you use on this stove, because you don't want the flame actually melting the bottom of your pan, saucepan,
yeah, sure,
or you, kettle.
Oh, yeah, you might be able to do that, especially if you use copper,
because this burns a lot hotter than your normal gas stove.
And always remember that at some point you'll have to clean out your electrolytic cell, because your electrodes will break down and it will get dirty,
mucky,
and horrible.
Yes, so you'll have to flush it through with water.
So you'll have to flush it. You'll have to clean it. In other words, of course. Because the water doesn't break down.
Yeah. But apart from that, it's a great buy.
Because when you think about it, the fact that you do get your electrodes decomposing and the water goes all mucky, especially when you're using
iron
as your electrodes, that's proof in it. Well, that is certainly evidence to support the view that the gases do not come from the water. Gases came from the water, you wouldn't expect to see your electrodes break down. Yeah. It would just be the water that's breaking down.
Yeah, yeah.
But because the electrodes break down, that says it all, doesn't it?
Let's take this off.
So thanks ever so much to whoever gave us that link to that one. Another, but it's not water powered. Always remember, you can't get anything
with
producing flame that comes from water.
But water can carry the energy.
Yeah, you can use water to produce the flame, obviously, you know. Or to carry the energy, yeah, of course.
Then used
but
to
you're
produce
not
the flame.
Breaking water down to make hydrogen. You can't do it.
That's right.
It's a misnomer.
That's right. There we go. Thanks so much
for that one. What's next then, Peter?
Well, let's have a look at the liquid hydrogen and silicon dioxide.
Where would that be? I've got to remember. That's a hard one, that one, isn't it?
Let's have a look at hydrochloric acid then.
Yeah, let's have a look at hydrochloric acid.
This is, how does the solid work?
I'll just maximise the screen there.
I posed this as a question to somebody I know who's done a bit of kind of biology in the past.
Sure, yeah, cool.
Because I actually said, well, how do we know that we have hydrochloric acid in our bodies, inside our stomachs, that digests the food?
Well, it breaks down the food, you know.
So let's read about how mainstream understands how the stomach works.
Yeah, sure.
So the stomach is a muscular, hollow organ. It takes in food from the
esophagus,
mixes it, breaks it down, and then passes it on to the small intestine into small portions. The entire digestive system is made up of one muscular tube extending from at the point where the esophagus leads into the stomach. The digestive tube is usually kept shut by muscles. It's just explaining about the action of eating.
Really. Absolutely, yeah, sure.
It's not like explaining how the stomach works.
Yeah, the upper left part of the stomach near the opening curves upward towards the diaphragm. This part is called the fundus. is usually filled with air that enters the stomach when you swallow.
Yeah, but it's just explaining the process of
it. Yeah, sure. In the largest part of the stomach, called the body, food is churned and broken into smaller pieces, mixed with acidic gastric juice and enzymes, and pre-digested.
The exit of the stomach, the body.
You don't need that one.
Yeah, gastric juice. Here we go. Gastric juice is made up of digestive enzymes, hydrochloric acid, and other substances that are important for absorbing nutrients.
Right, there you go. So it states that, okay, it's telling the reader, okay, that it's not an opinion, okay, they're putting it out as being true.
Yeah, it's
made up. Gastric juice is made up of digestive enzymes, hydrochloric acid, and other substances that are important for absorbing nutrients.
The hydrochloric acid in the gastric juice breaks down the food, and the digestive enzymes split up the proteins.
Absolutely, of course. The acidic gastric juice also kills bacteria. Blah, 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 blah.
Together with the bicarbonate, this ensures that the stomach wall itself is not damaged by the hydrochloric acid. Because everybody knows the hydrochloric acid is very strong. It's a strong acid.
Absolutely, of course. Yeah, it's got a pH of like 2, isn't it? Hydrochloric acid.
Yeah, something like
2, something.
But my question to everybody who's watching this video,
even if you're a globehead,
how do we know that we've got hydrochloric acid inside our stomachs?
Well, maybe what you could do is you could, maybe when you vomit, you could actually pH your vomit.
But that's only going to determine the strength, the acidity of the
juice. It won't identify what acid is present, will it?
Yeah. Well, to help people make up, provide us with an answer or provide us with some kind of direction, let's have a look at hydrochloric acid and how it is manufactured.
Oh, okay, yeah. Let's see how human beings make
hydrochloric acid. Which is allegedly in your stomach. Yeah, so here we go. Just scroll up.
No, I don't need to.
You just want to scroll up to the top.
You just want to go. No, I was going to.
Yeah, hydrochloric acid, also known as muriatic acid or spirits of salt, is an aqueous solution of hydrogen chloride.
Yeah, it is a colourless solution with a distinctive pungent smell. It is classified as a strong acid. It is a component of the gastric acid in the digestive systems of most animal species, including humans.
There you go.
Hydrochloric acid is an important laboratory reagent and industrial chemical.
So here we go. So how do
what they've done then is they've cut open a dead body, or a mammal, and cut up the stomach and found hydrochloric acid there.
But how do they
this
know
is what the, this is the impression that you're getting.
But how do they know it's hydrochloric acid?
Yeah, this is the thing. How would that work? Because they made bleach out of it. They may have made bleach out of it, gastric juices. You can have a bleach called gastric juice.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Gastric bleach.
Yeah. How did they find hydrochloric acid?
So let's have a little look, see how they discovered.
Oh, there you go. Well,
no, it's just developed, really.
No, no, no.
The isolation of hydrochloric
acid. If you go back up to the big.
Which is.
Yeah, hold on.
Which is that? No, no. Here, history.
Yeah, in the early 10th century, the Persian physician and alchemist Abu Bakr al-Razi. Said that quite well, didn't I?
Yeah.
Conducted experiments with sal ammoniac.
Ammonium chloride.
And vitriol. Hydrated sulfates of various metals. So that's where your origin of sulfuric acid would come from.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Which he distilled together, thus producing the gas hydrogen chloride.
In so doing, he stumbled upon a primitive method for producing hydrochloric acid. Absolutely, of course, yeah.
Take equal parts of sweet salt, bitter salt, tarbazad salt, ardani salt,
salt of urine.
After adding an equal weight of good crystallized sal ammoniac dissolved by moisture and distill, they will distill over a strong water, which will leave stone instantly.
Blah 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 blah. Yeah. So essentially, what they're doing is it was discovered through using sal ammoniac.
Ammonium salt.
Ammonium chloride.
Yeah.
So the chloride was the part of it where I sourced the chlorine part.
Yeah.
Sure.
There you go.
So
But so, the industrial development of hydrogen chloride is through the LeBlanc process, large-scale production of sodium carbonate, common salt which is converted to soda ash using sulfuric acid, limestone and coal, releasing hydrogen chloride as a byproduct.
Oh, right, of course, yeah, sure.
Yeah?
Yeah, so soda ash, yeah. So you've got carbonate.
So the source of the hydrochloric acid was sal ammoniac.
Do you not think that the coal... Hold on, let me think. Oh, because what they did was in the LeBlanc process, did they not mix the coal in with the limestone?
Yeah.
They mixed it all in, and then they obviously heated it up at high temperature.
All of the sodium, the salt.
All the salt, mixed in with the digestate.
Yeah, because the LeBlanc process produced a lot of residue that they couldn't get rid of.
Yeah, let's just go on here. Yeah, we did this a long
time
ago.
We don't need to look at that.
Yeah, I'm just having a little look. It involved two stages, making sodium sulfate from sodium chloride, followed by reacting the sodium sulfate with coal and calcium carbonate to make sodium carbonate. And then that would have given off hydrogen chloride. And that's how they made bleach many, many years ago.
Yeah.
They managed to capture the gas product, which had been hydrogen chloride.
So basically, to make hydrochloric acid is that they mix hydrogen with your chloride.
Or your chlorine.
And then they bubble it through water.
Yeah, basically. That's what they do. Yeah, sure.
So,
hydrochloric acid is usually prepared industrially by dissolving hydrogen chloride in water, which is basically what you said. Hydrogen chloride can be generated in many ways, and thus several precursors to hydrochloric acid exist. The large-scale production of hydrochloric acid is almost always integrated with the industrial-scale production of other chemicals, such as in the chloralkali process, which produces hydroxide, hydrogen, chlorine. So they obviously dry the chlorine, dry the hydrogen, because they're both wet gases from the electrolytic cell. In the chloralkali process, and then basically they just react them together to produce your hydrochloric acid.
Yeah. You know. So hydrogen chloride is produced by combining chlorine and hydrogen.
Right. Okay.
Now, as the reaction is exothermic, the insulation is called an HCl oven or HCl burner, which dries the gas as well.
Yeah. Absolutely. Of course. Yeah. And obviously it could make it, because of the heat that's involved, it makes it more potent.
That's right.
Especially if you want to have a high concentration of hydrochloric acid.
So if that's how man produces hydrogen chloride to make hydrochloric acid.
Yeah, we've now got to ask,
where's the hydrogen and where's the chlorine gas in the body to make the hydrochloric acid within the stomach?
Yeah. Anybody got any ideas? In order to make hydrochloric acid, you need chlorine and you need hydrogen.
And also you need heat.
You need a lot of heat. So how does the body produce or make hydrochloric acid?
Yeah.
What is it? Just magically, abracadabra, Hesto presto, make me some hydrochloric acid.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 4.
Blah, blah. It doesn't work like that, does it? The human body can't make hydrochloric acid.
Yeah.
Can't do it.
Yeah, and in my understanding, without going into too much detail about this, in my understanding, all that happens, because isn't it funny, one thing I've noticed is that when you're sick, not that I'm sick often,
when you vomit.
But when you vomit or when you bring up some food stuff that's been digested, it's got a smell of vinegar.
Vinegar, yeah.
Now, in my understanding, vinegar is a product through fermentation. And that's all that happens in your
That's what we think happens in your stomach to the food.
Ferments the food that you've digested.
Absolutely. Well, that's what basically happens to your food.
Yeah.
You don't digest it. It ferments. And it ferments, and then obviously you get an acid that's produced, and that is acetic. It's kind of acetic acid.
Yeah.
That's what we think, Let us know what you think. Yeah. Absolutely, of course, yeah, you know, I mean, I've tasted vomit, you know, it's not nice, but it does have that vinegar kind of taste to
smell,
it.
Smell, yeah.
And it's got that smell, you know. Yeah. Vinegar, very, you know, it doesn't taste or smell like hydrochloric acid, you know.
Chlorine.
Do you know what I mean? Just doesn't do this.
Bleach.
So I think, in my own personal view, I think that the stomach does not contain hydrochloric acid at all.
Yeah.
I think that's just total rubbish.
Yeah, but if you are a globehead out there and you've got proof that it is hydrochloric acid, please let us know in a comment below.
Yeah, and we'll obviously have a look at it, and
we'll correct ourselves
if we're wrong. We'll correct ourselves.
There you go. But
if we're not, we'll correct you instead.
Go on, then, click it off.
So we can click that off. So that bye bye hydrochloric acid.
Yes, you can click it off now.
All right. Yeah. Of course. Yeah, we've got that one now.
Here we go.
We don't need to do that one yet.
The Large Hadron Collider, Tropica Optica.
The Large Hadron Collider, 60 Minutes archive. 5 days ago, this video, so it's quite recent.
Now, buried 300 feet underground, the collider smashes subatomic particles together with enormous energy. As Leslie Stahl reported in 2015, by studying the collision, scientists made a major discovery, the Higgs boson.
Wow, the Higgs boson.
Nobel Prize winning physicist Peter Higgs, the particle's namesake, died this week at 94.
Oh, that's why they've done the video.
60 Minutes is the most successful. In this episode of 60 Minutes, we are going to celebrate the life of Peter Higgs.
Well, whoopie do, you know.
So he allegedly theorised this Higgs boson, but they've never found it, really.
Well, they'd argue that because they've got evidence to suggest that it is there.
But they haven't really found it.
Well, they've got no proof that it's there. Of course, the God particle, you know. And then they call it the God particle.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
it's just nuts. But let's have a little listen to this
rubbish.
This rubbish, because, you know, yeah, we've got to listen to this rubbish. Okay, are you ready? Listen to this rubbish.
Yeah, this is a woman, by the way.
Yeah, it is a woman.
Hadron Collider is one of the wonders of the modern world. It's believed to be the largest and most complex machine mankind has ever created. Buried hundreds of feet beneath Switzerland and France, the collider smashes subatomic particles together with enormous energy. By studying the collisions, scientists have already made a major discovery, the Higgs boson. Some call it the God particle. They're now hoping to learn a lot more, because after 2 years of repairs and upgrades, the collider has begun smashing particles at nearly double the power. The things it's searching for now sound like they're straight out of science fiction. Security is tight at the Large Hadron Collider. You need an iris scan to get inside.
Thank you. You have been identified.
The entire complex is buried deep underground.
You can see power, cooling.
And this is the heart of it.
Is this where the collision takes place?
The protons come down this pipe, down this orange pipe.
American physicist Greg Rockness showed us one of the four detectors where subatomic particles called protons ram into each other at nearly the speed of light to simulate conditions that are believed to have existed when the universe began.
Is there a boom? Is there noise?
There's no noise, but there's a flash of light, and the particles fly off, and you're taking a look into the basically a microscopic view of the Big Bang.
This is what the inside of the detector looks like. It's stuffed with magnets, electronics, and sensors. Creating a miniature version of the Big Bang isn't easy. Before the particles get here, they travel through a long tunnel that Rockness took us down into during a maintenance break.
For 17 miles?
For 17 miles.
In a big loop, a big circle.
In a big loop, that's right.
The loop runs beneath the countryside of Switzerland and France, not far from Geneva. The tunnel is so vast, workers zip around on bicycles. The particles zip through these pipes, guided by super-cooled magnets.
When the protons are going through the tunnel, it's very cold. How cold does it actually get?
It's somewhere on the order of negative 450 degrees Fahrenheit.
Is that colder than outer space?
That's colder than outer space.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
Now, I hear that when the collision takes place, that the temperatures spike. They go way high. How high do they go?
They can be up to the order of 10,000 times hotter than the center of the sun.
No.
Yeah.
So it goes from the coldest ever to the hottest ever.
Yeah, in...
Like that?
Yeah.
The data is analyzed by thousands of computers here and around the world.
I can't understand how man can build equipment and machinery on this scale that can withstand temperatures from one real low cold range.
I know, -400, wasn't it?
-400 Fahrenheit to the opposite.
Oh, Fahrenheit.
Mega hot.
No, it's just
ridiculous.
But the thing is, they make these claims, but he doesn't prove that what he's telling you is true. This is a big thing. He may as well be a politician, because they come out with lots of stuff that they never prove, and no interviewer ever asks them for any proof.
Oh, well, yeah. Oh, Saddam had weapons.
Well, statistics show that unemployment fell down this year. You know, came to an all-time 30-year low. Well, where's your proof of that?
Yeah.
Oh, don't ask me that.
Oh, Saddam had weapons of mass destruction. In Iraq.
You know, it's just when you get to become a flat earther, you start realizing that a lot of people do come out with rubbish.
Well, they come out with wild, fantastical claims.
As of course, yeah. And none of these people actually show you any information. Yeah. To support those claims.
And the worst thing about it is that the presenter of this video, and also a lot of globe heads, would just be talking to that guy here, wow, I'm in awe of what he's saying. -400. Wow, temperature is hotter than the middle of the center of the sun. Wow.
Yeah, it's phenomenal.
It's fantastical.
You know, I mean.
They haven't even got any... they don't even have any thermometers that can measure -400 degrees Fahrenheit.
How cold is -400 degrees Fahrenheit? I don't know. In centigrade, I mean.
I don't know. You'd have to Google it.
You don't mind if I Google it?
Oh, go on, Google it.
Let's Google -400 and -400 degrees Fahrenheit in Celsius.
Yeah, that's fine.
Is that right? Yeah, Celsius. -240.
Maybe the cold they can actually determine, but not hot temperatures.
Yeah, I mean, how can they
measure temperatures? Where the center of the sun, the temperature of the center of the sun.
Yeah, apparently they...
According to mainstream. Okay, I'll give them they could probably measure the...
look at that.
27 million Fahrenheit.
Well, and what he's...
In centigrade, go on.
In 12, right, yeah.
15 million Celsius.
Fifteen million Celsius. I mean, how can they
use to measure? This is another thing about...
No, it's calculated.
Yeah, this is the thing. They calculate what they think is the temperature inside the Hadron Collider.
Because they can't measure it.
They don't actually put a thermometer probe inside and actually take a reading.
Yeah, they don't do that.
They don't do that. It's all done through calculation.
Yeah, I mean, they can. These people can create a reality just basically by pure calculation alone. And all these Globey people will accept it to be true.
Yeah, I know.
All of them.
Yeah.
Because they've got mental health problems. Yeah, it's not my fault they're not right up there. Yeah, it's not my fault, is it?
Yeah, anyway,
you know,
but we don't need to cover the
the
rest of the video, really.
Well, we don't really need to cover, you know, the hows and whys of the Large Hadron Collider. But as far as we're concerned, our take on the Large Hadron Collider is that it's just a load of shit. It's just there to give people jobs.
Yeah, these scientists.
Essentially, that's what it does do. People go there, they go to work, they get paid, and then they come home. They may not have found anything during that particular day, that particular week, that particular month, but everyone's getting paid.
That particular year.
That particular year. But everybody's getting paid.
That particular decade.
Absolutely. And it also fills up educational establishments because people, when they go to university, they can learn about the Large Hadron Collider. These people probably have schools, I'm sure, or students visiting the Large Hadron Collider just to act as a propaganda machine to ensure that drive the nail home that atoms are real.
Yeah.
You get it into your thick skulls. Atoms are real. Subatomic particles are real.
Yeah.
We've built this Hadron Collider. They've got to be real.
Do you think we'd build this if they weren't real?
Absolutely, of course, yeah. But they're creating it. Because all they're doing, but in our view, all they're doing is basically they've got a vacuumed circuit.
Yeah.
Okay. It's all in a vacuum.
Yeah.
And all they do is fire voltage at high speed, and it's accelerated around using magnetism. Okay, to pull it through. Okay, and then they just collide it with another piece of voltage.
Yeah. Or they just whack it into something.
Or they blast it into something and see what happens. That's all they're doing. They're just fucking about with something.
Yeah.
And they, as far as I'm concerned, they're not getting anything out of it, because what have they got out of it?
Yeah, I
apart from a Higgs boson. But how has that changed your life?
It hasn't.
It's not changed. Yeah. It's not changed my life.
Hasn't changed my life.
It hasn't changed this guy here. Hasn't changed his life, because he's still working at the Large Hadron Collider.
Well, you could argue it has changed his life, because he may have booked a holiday.
This guy is able to go to work. Yep. He's able to draw wage. Yep. He's able to go on holiday.
Buy a car.
He's able to have a pension. And when he gets older, he'll be able to retire. He can even do some teaching in a university or some other establishment.
Or he could go around a lot of educational establishments.
Yeah, and give talks about the Large Hadron Collider. But at the end of the day, what they're actually doing, and the subatomic particles may not even exist. Do you understand? You know, it's all a lie.
Yeah.
Well, it's all bullshit.
Yeah.
It's all rubbish.
Bullshit.
It's all rubbish.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Now, if you think we're wrong, you know, if you think, I mean, all they've got here is just, look, computer animated animations on screens.
Yeah, everything's built by man.
Yeah, the monitors they're looking at, the software they're using, has been created by human beings. So it's going to give them the result they're looking at.
Yeah,
look at the animation.
Yeah.
You know, they can't even show you the real thing happening.
Inside
what's going on.
Oh, yeah.
They haven't a clue what's going
on.
They're just fucking around.
Yeah.
For fucking around's sake. For the sake of it.
Yeah. Creating their own reality.
Creating a reality, yeah. That's all they're doing.
Yeah, sure.
Look at what they've built.
Yeah.
Just out of an idea.
Yeah.
Isn't it amazing?
And that's got to withstand temperatures over 15 million Celsius inside.
That's just absolutely ridiculous.
It's crazy. Out of this world.
But it's crazy talk when
crazy
you think
talk.
About it, you know.
And people like this bloke is so detached.
Oh, isn't he the...
Peter Higgs, yeah.
Oh,
he's so detached. He's so detached from the real world.
I bet he doesn't even know what he's talking about the Higgs boson.
Yeah.
Well, what is it, mate? You know.
No, look. It's all calculated.
It's all theoretical. It's in his brain.
Yeah, that's all. It's in his brain.
It's in his brain. It's in his mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's where the Higgs boson is. Because there is no proof that even a proton even exists.
Yeah.
You know, there's no such proof.
And yet, to only make his formula to be kind of have some kind of substance, they have to build equipment that he thinks will be able to find it, discover it. Yeah, because they got that bit there.
You got this bit here. Yeah.
Do they actually play the sound? If you play the sound...
this is where he gets...
play the sound. Hold on. The guy there, this guy here, just play what he says, this guy. Go on, just play it here.
After this sequence.
Yeah, here we
listen.
Go.
Absolutely clear. That had to be something that we haven't seen before.
I think we have it. You agree?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he says, I think we have it.
Yeah, so let's just play that again, yeah.
Absolutely clear. that had to be something that we hadn't seen before.
I think we have it.
I think we have it. He's talking about the Higgs boson.
He never said, we found it. We've discovered it. We've got it.
It's just, I think we have it. I mean, that's not really scientific. No, it's not really, it's not really concrete, is it?
I think we have it, yeah.
But because that includes the possibility that you might not have it.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
you know. And if you haven't got it, then what's the point of you doing what you're doing? You know.
And all these people in the audience think that they have got it.
Yeah, think that on the basis of a thought that this other guy thinks they've got it.
Yeah.
Everyone else thinks they have got it.
Yeah. So the audience thinks they've got it, whereas that bloke only thinks that he might have.
Yeah, he might have got it. Yeah, he thinks they might have it, whereas everyone else thinks they have got it. Yeah. This is why it's mad. I mean, listen, you know, listen to the audience, yeah.
You agree?
Yeah.
In the audience, the one-time eccentric teared up. This guaranteed Peter Higgs a place in history.
A place in history for the educational
establishment. Yeah.
Peter Higgs, well done, Peter. Your name is going to be taught in schools, and it's going to be taught in universities across the world
from time immemorial.
You'll be like Newton, mate. Do you know what I mean? And look where Newton goes. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When you leave your educational establishment, you can get in the real world. You're gone.
It's gone.
You don't even think about Newton.
Nobody wants to know.
Absolutely. It doesn't even come into your mind. Yeah. Newton's third three laws of motion. Yeah. I mean, come on. When you get in an aircraft, you don't think about Newton's three laws of motion, do you?
No, you don't.
Or when you get into your car, do you know what I mean? You don't. Or when you're walking down the street, you don't think about Newton's third law of motion, three laws of motion.
Or if you're going through,
absolutely, of course.
Or if you're going through a dating site or sexting with your partner.
Absolutely, of course, yeah.
You don't need to know about laws of motion.
Absolutely, yeah. You don't use Newton's laws of motion at all.
Yeah.
You don't use them. All of this stuff is just for the education.
Yeah.
To the propaganda.
The masses.
The indoctrination. Because it's helping science indoctrinate people. So they won't be sure of a few silly people to absorb their rubbish.
Well, it's just more bullshit for people. Absolutely, of course. Yeah. Anyway, come on, let's move on.
It's their little dream. Yeah. That's all it is.
Come on, let's move on.
Now, if you think we're wrong, then you've got to prove to us that these photons do exist.
Or
these things that allegedly are zipping around this Hadron Collider.
Yeah. Or you've got to try and convince us that the bloke actually said, I know we've discovered it.
Yeah.
Not, I think we have it.
Well, you've got to explain why he said, I think we have it. Yeah, no. I think we've got it.
Yeah, I think we've got it. Yeah, I think... Yeah,
sure, but you know, it's total bullshit.
Anyway,
in our opinion,
click off.
So there we go. We've got that one. We don't need that one.
So we want silicon.
We don't need that one.
Silicon. Yeah, can click that off. Click that off.
Click that off.
Click off that one. Yeah,
and click off that one.
Yeah, just click on the liquid hydrogen.
Can we not do?
Oh, here we go. Here we go.
Wowie's comment. And we got
Wowie 1802 left us a comment on one of our previous videos, and he asks, "Is there really?"
Oh, hold on.
An ozone layer is denser than air and above cold air minus 50 degrees, because obviously
it's denser air.
If you go up higher, it gets colder.
Yeah, when you go up higher, as you ascend, it gets colder and colder.
So we replied to him.
An
ozone layer.
An ozone layer.
Yeah,
never experienced that. Yeah, because obviously I'm just.
Yeah, so he's put, I meant ozone or O3. So we reply to him, air has a molecular weight of 26.
Yeah.
Ozone has a molecular weight of 48, which is more or less double.
And you can check that information with the gases density if you want to. I've just got to find, which one is it? It's that one there.
And we all know something heavier than air will always sink to the ground.
So remember, so think about it logically, okay? You don't need to have a degree to understand this, okay?
Yeah.
So the molecular weight of air is 26, okay? Put your degree to one side, you don't need it, it's very simple.
Yeah.
And now the molecular weight of ozone is 48. So 48, you'd agree, is heavier than 26, yeah? Okay,
yeah,
you've got
to.
Good. So molecular weight of 48, the ozone, is heavier than air. So how is it possible that ozone is above the air?
Yeah, high altitude.
At high altitude. Yeah? Can you
I think people can...
Can you get that?
Yeah.
Now, we understand it to be total bullshit. It's just bullshit. It's got to be bullshit, hasn't it? There's no way that this ozone gas, O3, can actually be up there at high altitude when it's heavier. The density is greater than air. Yeah?
Yeah. I'll delete that comment because everyone else does agree or does think that ozone is up there.
Yeah, a lot of people think it's just like some of the noble gases as well.
Yeah, the noble gases are exactly the same. A lot of flat earthers think it's the noble gases that create all the colours of the sky.
The daytime, evening twilight, sky, twilight, yeah.
But it's not, because the noble gases are heavier than air.
Yeah, a lot of them are heavier than
air.
They
all are.
Oh, okay, they all are.
Apart from helium.
Yeah, so apart from helium, the rest of them will just fall to the ground because they're heavy.
Yeah, be on the ground here.
Yeah, you would agree, yeah?
Oh,
you get that?
I've just found some xenon.
Or unless you think that heavy stuff things will be lighter than lightest things.
Maybe we're all upside down, perhaps.
Sure. So we all know something heavier than air will always sink to the ground. So I can't see how there can be an ozone layer. Yeah, how can there be an ozone? I remember the CFC scares, years ago with those polystyrene cartons, And they were all talking about the ozone layer, hole in the ozone layer. What ozone layer? Right.
Yeah,
there is no ozone layer.
Yeah.
There can't be an ozone layer because it's heavier than air.
Think about it logically.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same as trying to get a when a globey says that the water's curving, and everybody knows water will always find its own level.
Yeah, but nobody's showing you curving water, and nobody's also showing you the ozone layer itself.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
What's the point of science coming out with all of these claims when it can't prove them to be true?
Yeah.
Because it's only rendering itself and a lot of its claims to be unscientific.
Yeah, come on up, come on up, clear off. Stuart Gray's comment,
this would be this one.
Now, we did a video some time ago.
Yeah, this is a good video, actually.
100% conclusive proof rockets do not work in space. And what we did in this video was that we made a balloon car, but a lot of globe heads say that if you blow a balloon up and you release the balloon.
Oh, yeah. This is, wasn't it?
The air inside the balloon. As the air goes out,
is expelled out of the balloon lip.
It creates a force inside the balloon that pushes it forward
in the opposite direction. So there's a little diagram explaining that point of view.
So what we did, because we think that's a load of rubbish, because it's the air that exits the balloon interacts with the surrounding air outside.
Yes, totally did.
So what we did in this demonstration is we blew up
made a balloon car,
and on the exhaust pipe what we did is that we put fitted a cone on the end of that exhaust.
Over the exhaust.
So that the air from the balloon could easily come out, exit the car.
So we see the balloon car moving. Yeah. It's moving, it's doing well. So what we do is we get a cone and we put a cone
on the end of it. There we go.
Oh, there's the cone. And we stick this cone over the straw at the end where the air exits the balloon.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because we're still allowing the air to come out the balloon, exactly in the same as it did before.
So we're not inhibiting any of the air from exiting the balloon. We're not doing that at all.
So according to a globe head understanding, it should still work.
The
balloon car should still move forward.
Yeah, absolutely. And it will move forward even with the weight of the cone because it was card, light card.
Yeah, it was light card. It wasn't heavy.
Absolutely, of course. So we end up pumping up the balloon. So here we go. We're pumping the balloon up there, as you can see.
Yeah.
And with the cone on there. And
you blow the balloon up quite a lot as well.
Yeah, I think about 20 times, isn't it? Something. It's quite a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Look at the size of that balloon. It's unbelievable. It's quite big. So you'd expect, really, if their understanding of how a balloon is propelled around in the air when you let go of it, an inflated balloon, if their understanding is correct, the air exiting the balloon, okay, will exit this. Will exit this balloon. Okay, come out the straw, go through the cone. Okay, and then that will induce a force in the opposite direction inside the balloon to push it forwards. Okay, this is what should happen. So this should move.
Yeah,
it should move.
Yeah.
Okay, and you know, when we did it, it didn't move at all.
Why doesn't it move?
It doesn't move because we have prevented the stream of air that exits the straw from interacting with the air surrounding air. We've blocked that. We've stopped it. This proves essentially that it's the interaction that the exhaust stream has with the air surrounding air that is essential for propulsion. When you're looking at rockets or when you look at this kind of propulsion methods.
Right, so
it is conclusive proof.
As far as I'm concerned, nobody can disprove that.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. I mean, it's a great little demonstration.
But anyway, with Stuart Gray.
Anyway, somebody left a comment here. Obviously, these Globies think you're still wrong. Yeah, they've watched the video and you're still wrong.
But Stuart Gray, so please explain. 5 days ago, it was only recent. So please explain how rocket engines cause the mass of the exhaust gas to be accelerated. Do rockets use magic?
Yeah, so basically, he's still clinging. He's seen the video. We're going on the assumption he's seen the video.
He hasn't seen the video.
Well, we think he may have seen the video, but he still wants to believe that he's right and that rockets do work in a vacuum.
No, that he's right in that the rocket, by creating
just by chucking something out the back, that will move the rocket forward in the opposite direction.
But we demonstrated in the balloon car that just by chucking something out the back won't move it forward.
It won't move it forward, even though you're chucking something out the back.
Yeah,
you can just imagine people like Stuart Gray on the back of a train, for example, throwing all this stuff out the back.
I know,
hoping to get it moving forwards, but it's just not moving forwards. Yeah. You know.
The guy's got
mental health problems. Yeah, sure. Acceleration is just one part.
I wouldn't go into it.
Are you not going to go into it?
I'll just go to the end.
We'll go to the very end. Yeah, sure. Blah, blah. Because we talk about a crossbow. We talk about
Newton's third law of motion. We talk about crossbows. We talk about recoil. We talk about a lot of things.
And then somebody else gets in.
But we need to get back to the video that we showcased with the balloon car.
Yeah, sure. I'm sure this bit here. That's the last comment.
All right.
If
you care to watch the video, we placed a nozzle over the end of the exhaust outlet of the balloon car, interfering with the exhaust interaction with the surrounding air.
Yeah.
The vehicle did not move, proving conclusively that the surrounding air creates the necessary resistance to the exhaust from the deflating balloon, enabling a reaction to take place in the form of motion of the balloon car.
Absolutely, yeah, of course, because he actually did.
In other words, rockets need something to push off from in order to work.
Oh, right.
No air, no motion.
Yeah, because this AM who got also involved in the conversation, he wrote, "You contradict yourself in this response. You acknowledge that the absence of air doesn't change the fact that you should still roll backwards when throwing an object." Because he brought in the idea of
throwing a med ball
in a chair, on a chair, and it's got wheels on, and you'll move in the opposite direction.
Yeah.
But as soon as the mass is gas and not a solid object, you think the ejected mass needs to interact with the air.
Yeah.
Why do you think the state of matter matters? If I sit in that rolling chair and throw the same mass of solid, liquid, or gas at the same speed, I'll roll backwards the exact same speed and distance in all three scenarios. He only thinks that.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
He only literally thinks that. He's never done that. It's like squirting, a compressed air nozzle, you know.
Oh, right.
Opening up. Psst,
psst, well, it's a bit like holding, you know, holding a fire extinguisher. On an office chair with wheels on it, and you've got a nice smooth floor, and you hold the fire extinguisher and you...
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. You're not going to go anywhere.
Just by pushing that out, you're going to move in the opposite direction.
But you're not. You're not going to do that. Because we basically come to the conclusion that a lot of these people use the med ball as the example. Well, you throw the med ball in one direction, you'll move in the opposite.
Yeah, but you're pushing on the med ball as you're throwing it.
And a lot of people have said that you need to push off from something in order to move. You can push off from the med ball.
Yeah. So if I'm holding this fire extinguisher and I pull the lever, I'm just allowing all this stuff to go out.
Yeah.
But what's it interacting with? There's nothing inside the fire extinguisher.
Absolutely. It's not coming into contact. Absolutely, of course, yeah.
It's got to interact with the surrounding air, because air is mass.
Air is mass. Absolutely, of course, yeah. Now, a lot of these globies, you know, they don't look at air, obviously, the surrounding air of a thrust column. And, you know, they don't understand that air has mass. And therefore, air can exert pressure.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it's like here. I mean, we haven't contradicted ourselves, because the med ball is a solid mass, whereas the exhaust from a rocket isn't. And also, you've got to remember that you're pushing the med ball.
Yeah, you're pushing on the med ball.
Whereas the exhaust from a rocket is actually going in one direction. It's being pumped in one direction.
Yeah.
It's just being pumped in one direction.
Yeah,
that's all.
Basically.
There's nothing inside the rocket that's pushing.
Yeah, I know, yeah, sure.
The gases out. It's been pumped out.
It's been pumped out, yeah, sure.
In that direction.
But, you know, these people...
And the exhaust gases are expelled much faster than a med ball can be thrown.
I know, yeah.
And again, if you care to watch the video, we place the nozzle over the end of the exhaust outlet of the balloon car, interfering with the exhaust interaction with the surrounding air. The vehicle did not move.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, rockets need something to push off in order to work.
And if you're talking about Newton's third law of motion... Newton was only looking at contact forces that involved things that had mass.
Absolutely. Law of inertia is an exact good example of that, because a mass will always move in one direction unless acted upon by another mass.
Contact.
So you've got the rocket's thrust going out in one direction.
Yeah.
What's it having contact with in a vacuum? It doesn't have contact with anything. So you're not going to get motion. You won't get anything, you know.
Yeah.
There's no resistance there.
Yeah, no.
There's nothing to resist that column of gaseous thrust.
Yeah.
That's if you can get, but you can't get hot gases in a vacuum.
Yeah, because
you can't get a flame in a vacuum.
Yeah. Well, you can't get combustion.
You can't get combustion in a vacuum.
But we always come back to our favourite one. Again, if you think we're wrong, try getting up from the toilet in the morning, or whenever you have your dump, when someone has taken away the floor.
Absolutely, yeah, of course, yeah.
You won't get up,
you know,
because there's nothing to push off from.
Yeah, you need something to push off from in order for you to move, you know.
Yeah.
And that's exactly the same with a rocket thrust generator.
But it's just another example where, just like the electrolysis, that they think the hydrogen's coming from the water.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
It's exactly the same with this. They're skewing the understanding
from
the actual natural physical
From the real life experience.
Yeah.
You know, these guys are detracted from reality, from the real world.
Yeah.
You know,
because they want to create their reality. They want to think it's a planet Earth.
But planet Earth is just a belief. That's all it is.
Yeah, and this is why planet Earth is just a belief, because people can't prove.
Nobody can prove
anything.
The shape of the Earth.
Anything.
And yet science comes along and says, but it's a globe.
Yeah, I know.
No, it's a globe. It's definitely a globe.
But they can't prove it.
I was out with Vic today, and people were telling me, no, it's a globe. And I'm thinking, but how do you know? You don't know that.
Yeah, I know.
It's it's just mad for all
Come
these
on,
people up. Walking past. Well, it's a globe. But how do you know that?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
No, but you've never been anywhere. You've just been to school. You've been indoctrinated.
You've just gone over to W.H. Smith and read a magazine.
No, that's not... That's not
oh, look, the Earth's a globe because it says it in this magazine.
You know, it just goes to show how...
But
how,
you have to pay.
Yeah, it just goes to show a lot of people just aren't critical. No, they don't use their... they lack critical thought.
Yeah, a lot of people don't want to realise that it's a level Earth, it's encircled.
And they're not
going anywhere.
Oh, yeah, guy today asked us, Vic showed one bloke did like a printout of the ice wall kind of thing he had, that Vic had. And he said, oh, get away, that's rubbish, that is. And I'm thinking, but part of Antarctica could have an ice wall around it.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
I'm not saying all of it. All of it can't have an ice wall because you've got McMurdo.
Yeah, shelf, isn't it?
Yeah, but you've got rocks and there's a base there, but there's no ice wall there.
Oh, right, yeah.
So an ice wall wouldn't go all the way around. You know, there's parts where you won't get that ice wall, but there are probably parts where there is an ice wall.
Anyway, come on.
Or it's likely to be an ice
wall. Come on, hurry up. I think we'd better leave the liquid hydrogen. And and the silicon oxide.
So anyway, so we've done that one.
Let's do a screwdriver, Joel Driver.
Joel, what's he talking about?
ISS
anyway?
Eclipse.
Oh, right. Oh, well, I haven't got his comment up, so we'll have to...
All right, we'll leave that one.
Have
you got the liquid hydrogen up?
Yeah, that's
silicon
good.
Silicon oxide.
I couldn't find it on the bookmarks.
Right, okay, well, couldn't we won't do that.
Yeah, we don't
Moon
do
that. Thorson, nuclear weapons, there we go.
Nuclear weapons. Oh, right, well, we can just talk about that, can't we?
No, if you get up a diagram of a nuclear warhead.
Oh, nuclear...
Now, everyone's familiar that Israel and Iran have been having a spat.
Oh, here we go.
And everyone thinks that Israel has nuclear weapons, and also Russia as well. Russia has nuclear weapons, and they think that Russia is going to fire these nuclear warheads at Europe, of all places.
Oh, right, yeah, sure.
Now, there's a lot of information about a nuclear weapon. A nuclear weapon is an explosive device that derives its destructive force from nuclear reactions.
Yeah. Get in the either middle of a nuclear reaction.
Either fission or a combination of fission and fusion reactions producing a nuclear explosion.
Mm.
Now, in our understanding, if you go down to
both bomb types release large quantities of energy from relatively small amounts of matter.
Wow, would that go against
thermite laws of conservation?
Yeah,
what goes in has to come out.
And like, according to this, what goes in comes out a lot more.
Absolutely, yeah, of course, yeah. The first test of a fission atomic bomb released an amount of energy approximately equal to 20,000 tons of TNT. The first thermonuclear hydrogen bomb test released energy approximately equal to 10 million tons of TNT. Nuclear bombs have had yields between blah, 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 and all this kind of stuff. A nuclear device no larger than a conventional bomb can devastate an entire city by blast, fire, and radiation.
Whoa,
they seem devastating, don't they?
Yeah. Since our weapons of mass destruction, the proliferation of nuclear weapons is the focus of international relations policy.
Yeah, nuclear weapons have been deployed twice in war. Oh, only twice? Hmm.
Yeah.
By the United States against the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945 during World War II.
Oh, here we go. So, okay. So, they're saying that a nuclear weapon will destroy... if you go up,
sorry,
can devastate an entire city by blast, fire, and radiation.
Yeah.
So logic has it that if these nuclear weapons are real and one nuclear weapon is dropped on a city like Hiroshima or Nagasaki, then that city
or Kiev or whatever,
that city would be exposed to radiation. Yeah.
Well, that's what it's saying.
That's the logic, isn't it? So, just as a bit of information, how long did it start taking the Japanese to rebuild either Nagasaki or Hiroshima? To begin rebuilding, only the rebuilding. Nagasaki. Restoration of Nagasaki was slower due to financial and did not start until 1946.
There you go.
And it was dropped 1945, wasn't it?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, wasn't it? Yeah, recovery time from a nuclear disaster, apparently. No?
Go on, Hiroshima. Let's go.
I'm sure Hiroshima only took a few months, I understand.
Hiroshima.
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 Approximately 2 years. No, the restoration process took approximately 2 years.
Yeah, and the city's population, which had dwindled to about 80,000.
Until March 1946, the ruins were cleared.
Oh, right, until.
And the buildings that were damaged but still standing underwent controlled demolition. So people were going in there.
Working away
just after.
Well, yeah.
Bombs were dropped.
Yeah, and how long were people out of Chernobyl? It was years, wasn't it? It was over 10, 15 years, wasn't it?
Yeah,
no, I mean, something's obviously not right here, is it? Is there, you know?
So there's a lot of information that's a bit kind of suspect. And also there's that view that I'm sure that...
It took two years.
It's our understanding that these Japanese cities were just carpet bombed.
Yeah, they were just carpet bombed. But our main, I'm sure a lot of people would agree with this, but our main criticism about nuclear weapons, the whole understanding or idea of nuclear weapons, because they're only an idea, nuclear weapons, but our main gripe with nuclear weapons is that you can't get a chain reaction. There's no such thing as a chain reaction.
Yeah, well, anyway, we need to look at what a chain reaction is.
Oh, wait there. Let's see if chain reaction is on the page. Yeah.
I'm in the middle of a chain. There you go. Fission weapons, a mass of fissile material enriched uranium or plutonium is forced into supercriticality.
Allowing
an exponential growth of nuclear chain reactions.
Yeah.
By shooting one piece of subcritical material into another, the gun method, or by compression of a subcritical sphere or cylinder of fissile material using chemically fueled explosive lenses.
Yeah, but you see, the thing is, you can't get a nuclear chain reaction. There's no such thing as a nuclear chain reaction.
That's theoretical.
Absolutely, of course.
In our opinion.
In our view, it's theoretical, yeah.
It's just like, because they say that you get a nuclear chain reaction in a nuclear reactor.
Now, to demonstrate that how confident we are with our views, I can guarantee you that nobody will drop a nuclear bomb with what's going on in the Middle East and in Ukraine, okay? Nobody is going to use a nuclear weapon.
Yeah.
Nobody.
Yeah. Because you might actually...
Nobody will.
Yeah. Because you might actually...
Because they don't exist.
Yeah. Because you might actually find that the idea of nuclear weapons is also a bit of propaganda for the West to be able to control developing countries to prevent them from actually developing their nuclear energy.
Yeah, because the last thing that's a good point. Yeah. Sure, the IEA could only be there.
IAEA, that group,
could only be there just to monitor how people use and develop nuclear power.
Yeah.
And that's all. Because they don't want people developing better techniques and technology than what they've got.
Yeah. I mean,
so the IAEA is a good way to monitor what other countries are doing with regards to developing nuclear energy.
I mean, if you think, we're not going to cover this in great detail, but for us to be able to think, yeah, okay, nuclear weapons are real, they are a real thing, then man obviously likes to build things, he likes to test things. He likes to experiment, he likes to fuck about with things. So he would have made a very small nuclear bomb.
A very small one, yeah.
And he would have tested it.
Absolutely, of course.
And he would actually demonstrate
it. Have recorded that demonstration.
Yes.
On video. And that video would be up on places on the internet somewhere.
Let's see a nuclear warhead weapon about this big.
Or let's see a nuclear weapon, a small mini nuke, that can actually kind of like explode and do damage to an area that's only 500 meters in diameter, which seems quite reasonable. Let's see the test area.
Yeah.
Let's see, you know, they always test their rockets, don't they? They always test their missiles. They always test their bombs. Always do.
Yeah. Let's see a bomb release large quantities of energy
from relatively small amounts of matter. That's what it's saying there. You know, but you can't do it, can you?
No.
No, you can't.
Because you can't do it.
They're all bullshit.
Because in our understanding...
They're just an idea.
Yeah, because in our understanding, the test that they did, whether you see with these nuclear blasts, is just a big pile of TNT.
Yeah, but yeah, we've seen... Yeah,
literally a big pile of TNT.
Yeah, sure.
That's all it is.
Yeah, they simulated.
Because they just want people to think... Oh, we could all die.
Absolutely, yeah. They want people to be on the edge of their seats and worried and fearful that...
No, let's not start a war with Russia.
They're all going to, yeah.
They should be out... A lot of it's just propaganda.
Scaremongering.
Scaremongering, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of people like to scaremonger.
So we've done that.
No nukes anywhere. No. And then you had C&D marches.
A couple of years ago,
you used to get C&D marches, yeah. Ban the bomb marches, all this kind of rubbish. And yet, what were they marching for?
It's just a waste of time, madness,
isn't it?
Yeah. Well, even Vic was doing it.
I know Vic was doing it at the time, but he realises how stupid he was. You know, but
and everybody should know, if you've watched the footage of the nuclear explosions, and because Eric Dubay covered them. And he was putting forward the view that you always see the same footage.
Same video footage.
And they all look like models.
They all look like models. Absolutely, of course, yeah.
All of them look like models.
Yeah, they're only... but that's what it would be like if they had nuclear weapons. Yeah. And they dropped a nuclear bomb.
This is what they think would happen.
Or this is what they would like to happen.
Yeah.
But that's it. But you've got all these. You've got a picture here. It says at the bottom, an assortment of American nuclear intercontinental ballistic missiles at the National Museum of the United States Air Force. They're not nuclear. None of them are.
Yeah, they're just missiles.
They're just missiles. That's all they are. They're just missiles.
Yeah.
With charges inside, you know.
Yeah.
But,
well, they may not even... Well, they haven't got charges inside.
Oh, no, these haven't. But, you know, they've just got... usual conventional arms inside
warheads.
Them.
Yeah.
Warheads. That's all they are. But they're not nuclear.
Yeah.
If you think we're wrong, you know, you're going to have to show us a nuclear.
No, show us a large release of energy from a small amount of matter.
Oh right, yeah. Both. Yeah, you got to show
large quantities of energy from relatively small amounts of matter.
Of course, yeah.
That's all you have to show
us. There's no point telling us. We want to see it.
Yes.
So we can accept it to be true. Yeah. Mm. Give us something genuine, and then
if you look at Russia and its pounding of Ukraine, you know, with their use of Fab 3000. Well, they haven't used the Fab 3000 as far as I'm aware, but Fab 1500s, Fab 500s. They're big heavy bombs. They don't release a large quantity of energy from relatively small amounts of matter. They don't do it.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. So, you know,
and yet you would think that if they had this small amount of matter that could release large amounts of energy, they'd be using them.
Small
amounts.
Well, they'd make them. You know, if nuclear chain reactions were real, you know,
so
they'd make all this stuff.
Whenever we see a story about nuclear weapons, we just kind of like
think it's bollocks.
Bollocks, yeah.
Yeah, it's absolute rubbish. Anyway, that's that over with.
Yeah,
we've done that one. I think we can
click that off, obviously.
Oh, here we go.
Oh,
this is the Just Add Water. How scientists are using silicon to produce hydrogen on demand.
Mm.
Isn't this amazing? It's amazing what these scientists get up to. Anyone would think they're bored and they've got nothing to do.
But they are.
And you've got this University of Buffalo. Come on, you scientists. We want to make some money. We want you to invent something so we can patent it. And then we can make money.
Yeah,
big money.
Because that's all universities are for. Is to make money.
Absolutely, of course. So they'll jump on the band, water is H2O bandwagon, like any other university.
Yeah, because universities are businesses.
Absolutely.
And they have to be making money.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. So we've got, this is allegedly a transmission electron microscopy image showing spherical silicon nanoparticles, about 10 nanometers in diameter. These particles, created in a UB lab, react with water to quickly produce hydrogen, according to new UB research.
Mm.
And this is the University of Buffalo,
yeah.
UB.
So where's the water?
So, anyway, well, come on. Well, where's the water? Where's the hydrogen and oxygen?
Yeah, I know. But anyway, come on.
All right, yeah. All right, yeah. Where's the hydrogen and oxygen, though? Think about it. They're in water.
No, they're just showing spherical silicon nanoparticles.
Oh, right. So why aren't they showing you in water?
Oh, well,
oh, sorry. Do apologise. Yeah, they would just...
Anyway, super small particles of silicon react with water to produce hydrogen almost instantaneously.
Boom!
In a series of experiments, the scientists created spherical silicon particles about 10 nanometers in size. When combined with water, these particles reacted to form silicic acid and hydrogen, a potential source of energy for fuel cells. So we're now understanding the water is just breaking down the silicon particles. That's all that's happening.
Yeah, the reaction didn't require any light, heat or electricity, and also created hydrogen about 150 times faster than similar reactions using silicon particles 100 nanometers wide, and 1,000 times faster than bulk silicon, according to the study. The findings appeared online, blah, 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 blah. The scientists were able to verify that the hydrogen they made was relatively pure by testing it successfully in a small fuel cell that powered a fan.
But how do they know the hydrogen is coming from the water?
Yeah, this is we're still asking that same question.
And not the silicon.
Sure. Mark T. Swihart, a UB professor of chemical and biological engineering and director of the university's Strategic Strength in Integrated Nanostructured Systems, said, when it comes to splitting water to produce hydrogen, nano-sized silicon may be better than more obvious choices that people have studied for a while, such as aluminium.
With further development, this technology could form the basis of a just-add-water approach to generating hydrogen on demand.
Yeah, sure.
The most practical application would be for portable energy sources.
A bit like the oven we saw.
Basically, a bit like your camping stove. But again, this isn't proving that the hydrogen is coming from the water.
Absolutely.
All that's happening is the water is reacting with the silicon, because also it probably creates an exothermic reaction. Bit like sodium hydroxide.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, because sodium hydroxide dissolves in water. And these silicon particles dissolve in water.
Yeah, because I'm unsure, even though they say silicon particles, I'm unsure exactly what they're comprised of.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They're not being clear. And they're also not saying whether they use another substance that's in solution with the water.
They don't
say that, but they could well add something to the water.
Yeah, and also one thing that they don't do, and that's they don't tell you how they manufacture the silicon.
Yeah, blah, 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 blah. So where are we now?
Super. Though it takes significant energy and resources, significant energy and resources to produce the super small silicon balls. So all that's happening is the water comes along and releases that energy that's gone into making the super small silicon balls.
Yeah, the particles could help power portable devices, blah, blah, blah.
Camping trips, there you go. Look.
Camping trips are two examples of such scenarios. Oh, absolutely, of course, yeah.
So we've done that one.
Well, I don't know. Oh, is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
All right, okay. Well, that's a bit boring. Close-up of spherical silicon nanoparticles, about 10 nanometers in diameter. The nano letters, UB scientists report that these particles should form the base of... Oh, they're the same as the ones at the top, aren't they?
Probably, yeah.
Just a closer image.
But anyway, the thing is that they're only these nanoparticles of silicon nanoparticles will only hold so much hydrogen.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely, of course, yeah.
But the thing we know is that the more energy that goes into making something, like titanium, there's a lot of energy that goes into making that metal, the more hydrogen it will release.
Yeah.
That's why the more resistant it is to corrosion.
Sure. But I've got to agree, and that is these nanoparticles do not, or this whole
this whole project
doesn't prove that water is made of hydrogen and oxygen. No. Just doesn't do it, because the gases, like the hydrogen especially, could be coming from the breakdown of these silicon nanoparticles.
Well, it is, in our view.
It's not water. Water's not breaking down. The water's breaking down these silicon...
Water's not... Oh,
the water's not breaking down these nano particles.
No, they are.
They're silicon nanoparticles.
Is breaking down. You got to word it right.
Oh, sorry, yeah, I've got to word this right, yeah. The water's not breaking down into hydrogen and oxygen. The water's breaking down the silicon nanoparticles to release the gases.
The hydrogen.
The hydrogen.
Within the silicon nanoparticles.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. There you go.
You know. Well, thanks, Anton, for that.
And if you think we're wrong, you know, you've got to then falsify our view by proving your own view.
Yeah.
So, and I don't know how you're going to do that. How on earth are you going to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the trouble is with man's world is that it's filled with dichotomies.
Absolutely, of course, yeah. But anyway, I suppose an interesting story.
Clear off. So all you got to do is Joel Driver. Clear that one off.
Joel Driver, I think we can
leave him.
Oh, we can go on this one,
yeah,
can't
we? Yeah, let's go on this one.
We might as well go on this one, for this is the last one, isn't it? And this one as well. Now, last week we got into doing, I think, Dave... Dave McKeegan's video, didn't we?
He covered.
And Dave McKeegan covered this video here, or this clip, where he had... he had the helicopter coming, rising from behind the water.
Yeah.
And now this guy, because we found this afterwards, a lot of you may have seen this already, I'm sure. But we got taboo conspiracy. Now he actually says that the video was faked. Okay.
Right. Okay.
Now, I personally think to myself, you know, we've seen the aircraft landing at Marignane Airport.
Yeah.
So this is kind of reasonable to accept that the helicopter can come from behind the water.
Yeah.
I it's reasonable to accept that. So I was very surprised to see that as Taboo Conspiracy went through the video, he actually noticed that there was some birds flying across as the helicopter rose. But there was also birds flying across when the helicopter was descending as well as ascending. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah. So I think he compares the two. And that was Dee Marble doing a bit there. So ascending clips unedited, so there you go. Right there, let's go. So you can see, there's the birds.
Oh, right,
can you see the birds
there?
Okay, and there's the ascending clip. Cropped and synced, here's both clips. So there, the top one is the descending clip, so the helicopter's descending, and the one on the bottom is where the helicopter's ascending. Okay, so, and just watch the birds fly. Yeah?
Oh, yeah,
they look very much synced with one another.
Yeah.
So one could definitely agree with the view that both video footage has been manipulated.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I would agree with that. You know, it's very. I can't see how you can get the two birds being exactly the same.
The birds.
Look, they come in even at the right speed.
Oh, right, yeah.
As well, you know, and more or less the
same
position.
They're at the same space
apart,
aren't they?
So, yeah, there is some kind of manipulation going on. However, okay, so we'll agree with that 100%.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day...
But we have been... We looked at that Marignane Airport video footage.
And the Oaklands Airport.
And the Oaklands Airport.
And it did look genuine.
And we would say that when you put a lens... close to the surface of water, what in a sense you're actually doing is you're bringing the visible horizon closer towards you, which means it's a lot higher because the visible horizon rises up to
what do you mean by the visible horizon is a lot higher? Well, you're bringing the horizon closer to you.
And as the visible horizon rises up to you,
that's
what you observe, isn't it?
You might find that the visible horizon is higher up.
Yeah, because and as it's coming closer to you, then it's obscuring what's behind it.
Oh, right, yeah, of course.
It's just a natural visual phenomenon.
Or an optical illusion.
Yeah.
An optical illusion.
All
right. It's a good point, that is. But it's more than possible that Taboo Conspiracy is spot on with that. And, you know,
there's a bit of fake
fudging going on
there.
But anyway. We actually got back on because we were looking for a bit of information, weren't we?
Yeah.
In an old
We were looking Earth for video. This test on salt and sea with Mark Sargent, because the Globehead,
in the team of Globies,
the Globe team, says very clearly, we recall, not that we didn't see any stars, but we recall that he said that this supports the idea of a globe.
Yeah.
He didn't say, there you go, the Earth is a globe. He doesn't say that. He just says that looking out and the ships, the boat appearing to go over the horizon supports the idea the Earth is a globe.
And now we were looking for that that one little clip of him saying that.
And we couldn't find it.
Couldn't find it, but we ended up going on this video anyway. And
this is from the Netflix
this
video.
Is, yeah, Round Earth versus Flat Earth, yeah, sure. Five years ago, it's unbelievable, isn't it? But it's amazing how time flies by. But they're all down at Salton Sea with Mark Sargent, you know, doing all this stuff, you know.
Some of you may have seen this.
Yeah, I'm sure lots of people have seen. So there's the woman in her car, you know. She's kind of like, you know, telling people that, you know, you got to be mad to think that the Earth's flat, you know.
No.
Can't believe it, you know. We've known that for thousands of years that the Earth's a sphere, you know, all this kind of bullshit that people come out with. Now, she has a little chat with a few people. Now, here they are at Salton Sea. They've all got their telescopes out and their optical instruments.
Yeah,
there.
Well.
You know, aren't they lucky people?
Well.
They're even measuring, you know, unbelievable, you know. And they get this red and black and white, red and black stripes painted on a white board or a white sheet. And they're going to take a boat out, with it, and they're just going to sail away from the shoreline. Now, she's given a very good diagram, because this is where the globe exists. It exists on a diagram.
Yeah, and in their heads.
And in the minds. It doesn't exist they can't use the real world.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know. So there we go. So they're trying to explain that this is what happens, to the bottoms of boats, you know. They're obscured by water, you can't see them. They're putting forward the hypothesis, the curving water hypothesis.
Yeah, so if you just... Just play it. So as the boat approaches the horizon, it appears to slowly dip down into the water before disappearing completely. That's got everything to do with the curvature of the Earth. If the planet was flat...
Oh, that's got everything to do with the curvature of the Earth. But they're saying that without any proof.
Yeah, I know. If the planet was flat, the entire boat would remain visible. So it'll be a very visual depiction of the...
of the something
curvature of the Earth. And what's really interesting is that some of the flat
earthers,
including Mark Sargent, are actually going to be here for this test. Right, anyway,
that didn't even make sense what she said, did it?
But anyway, when you actually watch this video, some of you may have already pointed this out, but we thought we'd cover it because we just think it's quite important.
They're out
into the water, and you can clearly see that white sheets with the stripes, coloured stripes on it. Look how high he is to the surface of that water.
Yeah, so obviously the footage must be the guy with his P1000.
Yeah, it must be, yeah.
I think he's just a quick...
Look how close he is. He must be about...
He must be about...
A foot off sea level.
Yeah, he must be about that much. Must be about, yeah.
Now, let's have a look.
300 millimetres.
Their understanding...
400 millimetres.
Yeah, their understanding is that you can't see the bottom of that sheet because the Earth's curved. Now, here we go.
And you see that, the red stripe...
You see the red stripe?
Yeah, because when you look at the image, you can't see the red stripe at the bottom.
Bottom, yeah.
You see the white stripe, and then a black stripe, then a white stripe, then a red stripe, then a white stripe.
Yeah, but you can't see the red stripe at the bottom.
Yeah.
So people think, well, it's going over the curve then, isn't it?
Well, you see, the thing is that the main thing here is clear, is that...
you can see water beyond it.
You can see water beyond it. Yeah, you can see water beyond it, so it hasn't really gone...
Over a curve.
Over the horizon. And yet you can still see the bottom portion of that sheet, hidden by water.
Yeah.
Isn't that surprising?
But you can see water beyond.
But you can see water beyond it. Now, this is odd. You know, and they don't mention that in this video at all.
Well, this tells me that there's undulations in the water.
And there's got to be undulations. Well, yeah, there's got to be, really, you know.
This is all this is showing.
Sure.
There's undulations in the water.
Yeah, I know,
If it was going over a curve, you wouldn't see water beyond that boat.
Absolutely, of course.
You wouldn't see it.
Yeah, because we know the boat's there.
Yeah.
But it's obviously that section there, that must be the peak of water.
Possibly.
And then it goes down. It must dip down.
Yeah,
it must dip down. So there must be like a swell.
Yeah,
a
swell,
yeah. Yeah, so that's what it's telling
us. The bottom has completely disappeared.
Yeah.
There you go.
And it's now getting closer to sort of the middle green. We've lost about one and a half.
So all they're looking at, all they're fixated on, is not being able to see that bottom stripe.
Yeah, but they don't realise they're not beyond the horizon. They're in front of the horizon.
Well, they're not realising that they can see water beyond it.
Beyond the sheet, you know.
Because if it was going over a curve, you wouldn't be able to see any water
beyond it. So this can only happen because of the curvature of the earth. You know, they put it down to the curve, but they've not tested it.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Yeah, it's mad, isn't it? These people
are insane.
Have got mental health problems.
This is why the globe Earth is only a belief. They can only believe it to be.
Absolutely, of course, yeah, they can only believe it to be. But as far as I'm concerned, you know, it's
that footage shows to me clearly. I mean, there's Mark Sargent, I don't know why he hasn't picked this up. But look, you can see water beyond the boats.
Yeah, and they put it down to the curvature of the earth.
How can
Mark Sargent and the other flat earthers, and the other have a very different interpretation of the results. So you don't think, and then she says, so you don't think that what we're seeing is actually real. In other words, she's skewing things and saying, so you don't think the boat's there on the water?
Yeah, it's not real.
Real. Is that what you're saying, Mark? Because she wants him to look stupid. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And yet, really, Mark Sargent should have said to this woman, look, granted, you can't see the bottom red line is being obscured, but you can see water beyond it. Which means that you're actually seeing undulations in the water.
Yeah, you're not actually seeing.
You're not seeing the boat going over a curve.
Absolutely, yeah.
You're not seeing that.
And it's just all bullshit, isn't it? You know,
you've got to be mad to think that it's curved.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
You have to be insane.
Yeah, and the worst thing is that a lot of these globey people will not accept that the globe Earth is just a belief.
Yeah, I know.
They won't accept that. They want it to be true. Yeah. This is the worrying part about it all.
Yeah.
It's quite worrying because people expressing that kind of view tells me that these people have got mental health problems.
Mm.
They're dangerous.
Well, can you imagine?
They're dangerous.
Can you imagine Netanyahu, where if somebody tells him, but sorry, Bibi, but we don't have any nuclear weapons because they don't exist.
Oh, right, yeah. So what am I going to do with these Gazans? I want them all to die.
Yeah.
Sure. But
it's absolute rubbish.
I know, yeah.
The shame is about all this.
The shite people put up with and are given and they think is true.
Yeah, but the shame about this is that it's not even picked up in the video. In the documentary. Why is it all the important things aren't said in these documentaries or in these discussions?
It's like
the white elephant in the room. You know?
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting one. So what could happen?
So, Mr. McKeegan, if you're watching, or what's his name?
I don't know.
Long-haired
lover from Liverpool.
Yeah.
Plan Our Walk,
you know. Why is it you can see water? Well, we know why you can see water beyond the boats.
Yeah.
Because it's level. But just have undulations in the water.
But then it gets to the horizon, the visible horizon, where you'll obviously get a swell.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll just get a swell.
Yeah.
That's what we think, you know, at the moment. You know, that's
and
what,
if you're gonna
how
get
we can interpret this piece of information.
And if you're going to get swells in salt and sea, you're bound to get swells out in the ocean.
Absolutely, of course, yeah, you know. I mean, that this image in itself is very...
Telling.
It's very telling indeed.
Bit, yeah.
Because this demonstrates that you do get swells and that water, you know, as it's moving, does have ups and downs.
Yeah.
You know, have bits like this.
Yeah.
It can have bigger waves.
Yeah.
Not just little ones, it can have bigger ones.
Yeah.
You know, like this.
I think we'll cover...
even that's an interesting idea, isn't it? It can have bigger waves.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, very wide waves.
We'll cover Joel's screwdriver his
next
eclipse.
But, yeah, you know, that's about it, really. So we've done that. We can go back on our... planet Earth, yeah. You know,
it's just a belief.
You know, it's just a belief. You know, I mean, lots of people consider this to be true, you know, that planet Earth is just a belief. Whenever you go into W.H. Smith or your news agent, or whenever you see the globe Earth, you know, image, you know, it's just, all it will do is conjure up inside your mind an ideology.
Yeah.
An ideology.
Visions of going to Mars.
Absolutely. And they'll all be existing in your head, in your mind.
Visions of Neil Armstrong on the moon.
And in order for that to be, in order for you to think that those images are real in the real world, you have to believe it.
Yeah, to be true.
You have to, well, you can only believe it.
Yeah, you can only believe it.
You
can
only believe it. That's the only way you can make it real.
Yeah.
Exist in the real world by believing it to be real.
You may as well swap your science book for a Bible.
For a Bible. There's no difference, is there? You know, all these people walking around believing in God, Jesus, and all this other rubbish. You may as well believe in that.
Yeah.
Ditch your globe and just believe in Jesus, you know.
Yeah.
No difference, So there you have it. Isn't that lovely? We've done all that.
There we go.
So there you have it. So thanks ever so much, and always remember till next time. If something doesn't make sense, like the planet Earth being real, or that nuclear weapons are real,
or your stomach being able to produce hydrogen and chlorine,
or your body producing it, absolutely, of course, because it's quite acidic, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you'd have to have. Reaching those high temperatures as well too.
Oh, because your stomach must be a HCl oven.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you've got to have an HCl oven in your tummy. You know, aren't you lucky to have that?
Yeah.
So, or if you think that fish breathe water, fish breathe oxygen, dissolved oxygen.
Yeah. Or if you think a nuclear warhead actually can produce large quantities of energy from small amounts of matter when no one has ever demonstrated it.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Or if you think something's real when no one's demonstrated it to be real.
Oh, right, yeah.
Or if
you
think something is true when that something has never been proved to be true.
Mm.
Of course, yeah. It's all fucking fucked up, isn't it?
Yeah,
of course.
I know, yeah.
So thanks ever so much, and we'll see you
next time. Okay.
Bye.
Ta-da.
The Earth isn't round, it's flat.
How do you know?
I've observed it in all my travels over Europe. It's flat, everywhere it's flat.